Life. So, welcome everyone to this week's community call. So, we're going to continue with part three of the Puck Scan mini series with our guest Romero, who is on the call with us, showcasing the change and details features. So, yeah, that's one of the key ones for today. So, glad to have you here. And following our regular DAO and community updates, we're also going to have a hot topic discussion regarding the WPOC, which has been a long, long thought after feature or item here that we've been looking forward to. So that's coming pretty soon. And afterwards, we'll do a little Q&A as well. So yeah, if you're ready, Romero, go ahead and take over.
Okay, thanks. Let me share the screen. There, can you see?
Yep.
Okay, well, today talk is about the chains, and the chains, to reach the chain section, you need to go to the explore section. This is the main dashboard. We always start here, and to reach the chains that chain section that will expand on what we see down here mostly, you'll need to go to the explorers and then choose either here on top the chains or look for the chains card. It's somewhere here. Yeah. Click. Well, this is the expanded chain section. It was designed mostly to help node runners and app users to see how how was the chain's performance regarding how much you could earn if you staking one of these chains, or how is the latency and the success ratio that you are to expect if you are an app user. This is the main part of the chain sections. You will see here also the relay distribution where we showcase the main chains in the network. So to have a quick look on how the traffic is divided today in the Pocket ecosystem, you see it's fairly divided among five that reach like 70%, should be a little less. It's been getting more heterogeneous in the last months. That's a good thing. And small chains have been growing. Below, what we see is that in this graph, the chain productivity is, its idea is to be able to compare how the different chains evolved in the time period. This graph is completely customizable. If you go to the little thing here and go to the year there and you go to settings, you can set, for example, the last year and summarize every day, for example, and you get a nice view of all the chains on its peaks. Let's give it some time to process for Pocket Scan. These graphs take a while because we need to process them. Not every time everyone is asking for such granular data, but we have everything that we wanted, even the high peak here when we reached the 2 billion relays that came from from Ethereum only. We only show the main three blockchains by default, because if you choose, for example, Ethereum and one of the little ones, it will be like a line that will make absolutely no sense. So for example, if you're interested in new chains, it's better just to go there, search for example, the Velas, click on them, and then take out the big ones to allow the graph to rescale. This is very useful when you're analyzing the small chains, which lately have been the ones that are driving most of the earnings. Everybody is aware that the guys like Ian and also Kramman are making great profit, and they make it mostly from all taking all these picks from these chains. So spending time here looking on chains about it's really interesting if you are an old runner. So if you are looking for something specific, for example, you decided that you are going to spin up a Bellas node and you want to know more about that specific chain, you can look for it in this card here that will give you more information about it. For example, if you go to Bellas, you just write the name or the code of the chain that you want to see, and you click here on this eye, it will bring you to a new window that is entirely dedicated to the specific blockchain. We have one of these for each of the blockchains that are currently active in the ecosystem, also old ones too, I think. So here, if you are an old runner, you can see, for example, this is something very interesting. It's how the relays evolved in the last few days, actually in the last month. We can also tune this graph. And you will see, Bellas, let's choose Bellas Archive, I think it was. There are some cool stuff here, 68, 69, or 70 was Oasis. I want to get to an interesting example. One second. Yeah, this is a good one. For example, if you are looking at these small chains all the time or any other chains, and you observe spikes in the traffic, you will also see that a few days later, the number of nodes grows with the spike. For example, here on the 14, 15, of this month, there was a high peak in the relays by node, in the total relays of the network, and it was shortly followed by a lot of nodes that entered and that were staked for this blockchain. So all these lucky guys that were from the 11th that saw these smaller peaks were able to profit a few days of a lot of relays by node, because after the number of stake nodes evolved from 200 to 1,000, the gains in this particular chain went harshly down. And probably these 272 nodes are Krapman and Ian. So this is how you can make a lot of pocket being a small node runner. So it's really interesting to observe and follow all these graphs. Something that many of you will notice when you explore this section is that the apps that are staked, the apps growth is actually a graph that should be like the nodes, but given the V0 environment, the number of apps is always fixed. You will see that there is always three in for most of the chains, except Ethereum that has like 1,000, but that's another story. But these three are the famous or infamous giga stakes that are used by the gateways to make all the traffic. So this won't change and this won't signal anything, but this is just to inform you that there are three staked in the network. So it's important to also notice, if you're a node runner, how much you will earn by placing your node in this very moment in the network. So in average, we will tell you how many relays did a node in the last 24 hours, 30 days, or the 30 days maximum. And also we'll tell you how much pocket are those nodes earning. It's important to note that this is a per node metric. So if you put one node, in average, you will be earning this much pocket a day just for having this blockchain. But if you are not a node runner, this page is also useful for you. For example, you want to use the OSS mainnet RPC from Pocket, and you are wondering how it will work in your region and what are the main quality of service features that this network has in the Pocket network. Well, this card here that says network data that sadly is being deprecated. Sorry, it's not being deprecated, it's its information is getting a little old, but it will be refreshed once we have the new metrics from PNI. But this card that is fed from cherry picker data mostly will show you an overview of the system first. It will tell you how is the overall success rate of this app, the main success, mean success latency. So this is milliseconds. It's 180 milliseconds. And this is the weighted success latency. This is a rather weird feature for an app user, but it's really interesting for a node runner. It means that you need to beat this number to be above the average. Okay, so let's say that you want to put your application on the OASIS mainnet and you want to do it on Europe. You know that you are near the Europe 1 server. So you go here and you can expand this tab. And this will tell you the following information. It will tell you what is the mean latency that you are to expect. It's 160 milliseconds. And that from all the nodes that are staked in the network, like there are like 1,000 nodes, this will tell you that in the last 72 hours, what we noticed is that there were 80 nodes that were really high quality nodes. Those nodes have less than 150 millisecond response time. And you will have 100 with medium and 26 that are rather bad. So you will be able to tell that your chances are rather good that you are matched with a node that is providing good service all the time. And you have this very same information for any of the existent geo zones. If you notice that some regions are like with very few data, for example, AP South 1 that has only one node, this means that there were almost no relays. Like, for example, 10 relays in 3 days is almost nothing. So if you start to use this and you start to pump relays through some of these zones, you can expect that we will start tracking you in no time, and you could use also this page to track those statistics here. So this is a small chain, but let's look at Ethereum to see a detail that I wanted to tell you. Ethereum is one of the largest that we have. So it's rather good to see the, for example, this here. This is the number 1,800 apps staked in Ethereum. This is one of the few that have this many, and this is from before the number of apps ran out. So from this 1,822, there are only 3 working. So this number is true, it's real, but the number of apps that are actually working is much, much lower. So don't get confused. This means that these apps are staked, but it doesn't mean that those apps are working. We will have to track that later, I think, when we have multiple gateways to be more aware. But also, it will also show you for an app user, this information will be much, much more rich, and it will tell you what is to expect when you start using intensively the Pocket Network. Ethereum is one of the main ones, so almost everyone is staking an Ethereum node. So as opposed to Oasis, where we saw that that you have like very few good nodes, in Ethereum it's the other way around. It's like 75% of all the nodes are very good nodes. So the chances are that if you are using Pocket for Ethereum, you are almost always matched with good nodes, and the cherry picker will take care of only send the relays to those nodes. These nodes that are rather medium or bad nodes are here because the cherry picker measures them, but most of your relays will end up in this large majority of nodes. And this is the behavior that we observe with all large networks, not only Ethereum, but it's also for Polygon. So don't, if you are expecting to use Pocket for a small chain, don't be afraid to, if you see low numbers, or like you go there and you see that this is only a small number of good nodes. The Pocket network adapts really quick, and if the blockchain is actively used, we respond rather fast and get to good quality. So, and I think this is all the details that we have from blockchains. I don't know. Yeah, I think this is all. I think that the last time we said that this graph was affected by the migration of the portals, but it's not. It's all blockchain data. So this graph is safe and you can continue using it. It's just a clarification that I just remember. But yeah, that's all for the chain section and details. If you have any question.
Awesome, thank you. Does anyone have any questions here for Romero?
Dave is typing something, and I hope it is the endpoint of their data that we want to have direly.
So Blades say that awesome work. It would be pretty cool to be able to enter your domain and Pakistan automatically make predictable analytics on which chain to support based off traffic volume stake nodes. Maybe a pro feature suggestion. So I think oftentimes we see new node runners join the chat and ask which chains to run.
Yeah. We have that actually, but we are thinking of it more as a pro feature. We don't want to have pro features in Pocket Scan, but running those things require heavy simulations, so it will be really difficult to be open to the public. So we had something like that, but it depended all on cherry picker data, so it's kind of not working lately. But yeah, maybe we can think of something, but it's really difficult to let it open to the public because we would require big servers on our side, and it's kind of difficult. But yeah, we can do it.
Yeah, maybe keep your fingers crossed and something will happen.
Yeah, we are always thinking on how to improve this. So maybe we think of something on how to run it lightly, but yeah. Or maybe in B1 it gets easier to calculate and we can open it.
There we go. Come on, B1. Right, any other questions for Romero? Or anything regarding Poxian? Looks like Zoolander is typing.
I'm thinking that we can maybe make some washed out simulation to tell you, hey, why don't stake in this one? You're alone and there is a lot of traffic there. Yeah, that could be easier to do.
Yeah.
If you're in a small node runner, it might work. But yeah, maybe we can think something. I hate when people just describe. These suggestions
Discord
end up in a lot of work for us.
You guys are in demand. So yeah, I guess one thing will be the Discord bot fee as a possibility as well.
Discord bot fee?
Yeah.
I don't know. I had some problems. I think Jorge is working on solving that. There was a problem with the webhook, I think. It's not my department, but yeah, we are trying to fix that. Yeah,
okay. Totally. So yeah, Zoolander stated, great work. How did you pull up the percentage of good nodes on each chain in the network data section?
We used the cherry picker data. We track all of the nodes' performance. We, if you hear the last talk when we talk about the geo section, there we have all the data about all the nodes in all the chains, and we just go into that database and say, okay, how many nodes are below 150 milliseconds on average? And those are the good nodes. How many are between 150 and 300? Those are the medium, and the rest are bad nodes. Just a simple threshold.
There we go. Any other question? All right, if not, we can wrap up for this section. So yeah, thanks Meryl for giving us this presentation, and feel free to reach out to him or go to their Discord if you have any other questions on that following this.
Yeah, okay, thanks.
Thank you. All right, and with that, we could go ahead and talk about some DAO and community updates. So for the DAO, PNF did release two different updates. So the first one is regarding the Into the Gatewayverse, bootstrapping a multi-gateway ecosystem. So the purpose of the project is to help the Pocket Network ecosystem make that leap from a single gateway to a multi-gateway. So yeah, what does that mean? So this is going to help remove any logistical barriers to the Pocket Network becoming a multi-gateway ecosystem. It's going to help support a second mover gateway to bootstrap their gateway and develop open source IP that will lower the barrier for entry for subsequent gateways that follows. It's going to help learn more about gateway operating to inform the refinement of the on-chain gateway actor mechanisms in V1. And it's also going to foster innovations in the gateway technology, which includes enhanced methods for data integrity, quality assurance, cost savings, and value-add services. And of course, this will also help diversify Pocket Network sources of protocol revenue. So a lot of things are going to be really leapfrog from this. So with that, I think Blade's on here, so I don't want to put you on the spot. But yeah, as Nodi has been one of the first to help lead the second mover in the Gatewayverse, which they have done a tremendous job to push forward in soft launching their RPC web app. And, you know, with us now having that 1 month into the road to revenue, we feel that this is now the time to further support Nodi's more directly with this bootstrapping grant and add on support by PNF and community members alike as well. What that means is that this is going to include a do not exceed budget of 300K in grants, which is about 50K per month for 6 months. Or sooner, if Nodes reaches a sustainable threshold. So yeah, to read more details about this, feel free to visit the discourse forum, and you can continue the discussion there as well to learn more. Or if you have any questions regarding this project, feel free to input there as well. And before I move on, anyone have any questions on this one? All right, moving on. The next update that we had posted is regarding the Stairway to Iridium, which is the upcoming launch of the WPOC. So as many of you know, that has been around Pocket for the past few years. Yeah, this has been a long coming in terms of plans to develop and launch a wrap version of POC. So yeah, this is some exciting stuff that are coming. And what this is going to represent is to help the represent the value of negative POC on a one-on-one basis with POC and wrap POC. And main benefit of being able to utilize the smart contract features and tools that's going to be available within the Iridium ecosystem, as that is the chain that's going to be launched on. So with WPOC, this is going to also allow for improved utilization of PAC as well as improving liquidity and SS. So there's going to be a 2% debt per our BHAG that will be provided to help with the liquidity. And now also to help PAC to be able to be listed on DEX. So that would be pretty exciting to have that SS available there. And of course, it can also ease up on the onboarding process too, so any future CEX exchanges, as they won't really need to develop a new chain or set up new nodes to run the platform in order to support PAC. So yeah, lots of benefits that will come from this. WPAC, as you have seen, is going to be primarily built by Raid Guild, which is also going to have a copper to support the custody of the funds. We're also going to have the external auditor and a law firm to support the development and the launch to make sure everything is good and ready to go. So budget for this project is set at a max amount of 150K to build RepPAC, and 75K as well will be utilized for liquidity incentives. As for the progress, it's been going very well. It's been going pretty smooth, and it's expected to be completed by end of August this year. So it's coming very soon. So with that, this really then leads us into the hot topic for today, which is RepPAC. So yeah, I mean, many of you has been around and have really thought of possible new utilities, or even, you know, think about how WPAC can be utilized. So just wanted to get some of your thoughts as well, and kind of learn what you think about the impact of what WPAC can bring, as well as what other possibilities it can help us achieve in the short and long term. So maybe even, you know, new socket ideas. So yeah, any thoughts anyone want to add? So one of the question would be, what are we planning to do with these tokens? We'll have to be able to use it with the EV. So I mean, that's definitely a possibility. So it's, you know, it's really up to the community too on what you guys will want to do in terms of utilizing it. I think the possibilities are really limited out there. And, you know, if anyone have ideas of what they want to build around it, you know, feel free. And of course, we always have the programs available too for anyone to utilize to help develop those programs and tasks. Liquidity pool, of course, will be part of it, and that's kind of the part of the 75K that we wanted to utilize to help boost up the liquidity.
I'll jump in, Ming. One thing just to sort of share that I'm quite excited about with RepPocket is it does. It does open us up to be able to use significantly more DAO tooling. I think for things like payments, particularly for its recurring work like sockets or bounties, it really sort of can make a huge difference. Today, like, we need to do monthly accounting of bounties, whereas with this, we can just release Wrapped Pocket direct from Dework in real time, or when a pull request is sort of merged, which, like, will make obviously a big difference to people working on bounties and make it a lot more fluid. The other thing is something with like sockets, we can do streaming payments so that it's not like you get paid, you know, $1,000 once a month. Actually, each day, Wrapped Pocket is sort of moving into your wallet. So, like, it's very exciting, I think, not just because of the liquidity it can bring to the DAO, but also our ability to sort of operate and interact with a lot of tools that we've been excluded from previously is going to be huge.
Yeah, definitely. So Shane's asking, is Rego doing the back-end bridge as well? Is it going to have multi-sig security?
Jack's on, so he can probably answer a little bit more on the details around that.
Yep, we're just trying to find the unmute button there. Red Guild is doing the bridge full stack. We're going to be using Copper for the multi-stick. The money that the foundation spent on Copper integration last year is paying off here, because we're going to be able to use that for this.
And Blade did provide some of the backend spec as well in the link within the chat if anyone wants to read more on the details. Again, feel free too to utilize the voice for questions if it's quicker. Got a few folks here typing. Thanks, Blade. So Alberto asked, which version of the Uniswap will the liquidity pool be for Repoc, version 2 or 3? I don't think version 4 will be in prod yet. I'm not sure we have the details on that yet to share.
I can maybe jump. I mean, my understanding is V4 won't be out yet, but I think when it is, it's definitely something we could explore.
Okay. So possibly V4.
But yeah, I don't think there's even any timelines yet for V4. It's like months away, TBD. So yeah, unclear.
Yeah, so I suppose if that's not ready, then V3.
Yeah, I think also like V2 maybe, I don't know, we're exploring a few different things, but V2 can be simpler in some ways, get started. But I mean, the thing is, we could always do both. There's also some strategies we've been looking at. For example, you know, we have a Hummingbot program live at the moment. Hummingbot will also do some like, they support DEXs as well, so you can do some sort of liquidity porting strategies, which could be interesting to sort of make it easier for people to arbitrage the DEX price and the centralized exchange prices. So yeah, there's a few little tricks we can explore as well.
Awesome. And Blade asked, do we know which chain we're deploying to yet? I believe it's the main Ethereum chain, right?
That's my understanding. We're just focusing on Ethereum initially. But I think from there, it wouldn't be too hard to also do a Polygon or something. But yeah, for now, the plan is Ethereum.
Thanks, Jack. I still haven't really used ChatGPT yet, so I'm interesting to test the waters on that and really see what it can do. Right, POC News asked, the WPOC budget is tied to the ERA proposal. Any time on when that goes to vote?
Yeah, hopefully tomorrow. Obviously, there's been a little bit of discussion around the extra funding that's been added for gateways. I think Nodies might want to add their voice to that sort of conversation as well. So plan to leave a little bit of clear air. But based on the conversations and descriptions we've had so far, we're relatively confident that people understand what they're voting on and what they're going to get in return for the funds that are provided. So, we don't want to dwell on that too much longer. The ideal scenario for us is that we start the first cycle at the beginning of July, which requires, going to a vote this week. So Not too much longer, or next 24 hours. I'm hoping that'll be up for a vote.
Awesome. Up and coming. I'm sure it'll probably be a nice turnout as well for that vote. Well, any other thoughts or around RAPOC or questions? Anyone have any ideas yet of what they might build around it? Since this will give us another path to think of ways to build for the ecosystem utilizing this. Looks like Puck News is typing. I wonder someday that you can just use like an analyst bot for to voice your chats, and then you can speak on the call as well. So what are the mechanisms to ensure a 2% death as stated in the post?
Sorry, can you repeat that? Sorry, what was that?
What are the mechanisms to ensure a 2% death as stated in the post for liquidity?
Yeah, sure. I mean, I think there's going to be a ton of different liquidity incentives. I think, like I mentioned, you know, we're exploring Hummingbot. We're also going to look to work with some market makers on it. I think it's one of these things that 2% depth has been a goal for all liquidity, not just RatPocket. It's something that we've sort of always like aspired to. And yeah, I mean, I think it you know, it's going to take time. We're going to have to bootstrap liquidity for RatPocket. It's not going to be as liquid as Pocket day one. But I think by introducing the right incentives and also just given time for the community to get used to the fact that this exists, we can get there. But I think also there's, you know, using things like V2 initially will kind of help, but it does also mean easy to get started with V2, Uniswap V2, I mean, but it does also mean like higher slippage. So yeah, I think it'll take a little bit of time for us to sort of work all this stuff out, but we're looking to do everything we can to sort of support that and make it as quick as possible.
Awesome.
But just to add to it, the ultimate driver of balance between RAPOC and Pocket will just be arbitrage, right? The fact that people can, trade the difference between the two and bring them in line.
Right, and Blade asks as well, are the WPOC signers going to be community-based or just Copper and PNF?
So I haven't been on the latest calls. I think as Dermot was on the latest ones, but my understanding is, yes, it will be PNF and Copper. There is a reality that using a custodian like this, there is some level, like it is a somewhat trusted setup. But we're trying to be as transparent and open about it as we can.
To get more context on the reasoning behind using Copper rather than multisig, the V0 of the protocol doesn't actually support N of M threshold multisig wallets, which basically means if you create a multisig in V0 and then are unable to get one of the signers, you're basically locked out of the wallet. We can't create like a 2 of 3, a 3 of 5, or whatever. It's 3 of 3, 5 of 5, 7 of 7, etc. So not the most secure. Well, I guess it's less about security in that case. It's more recovery and ensuring that that we're always able to access the wallet and make transactions and not get locked out. So that has necessitated using Copper. with V1, we would expect to have threshold signature wallets. So things can change with V1. But for now, yeah, we're relying on Copper.
All right, it looks like Alberto is typing as well. Yeah, some good questions so far as well to really expand on the post. So Alberto has said that MVM. Never mind. No additional questions from me right now. As some of you might know, Alberto has been around as part of PNI for quite a while, until earlier this year. So he's been around, knowing all this as well, for the development of RedPocket especially. So yeah, Shane asked if there are unique mechanisms that can be used with RedPoc and gateways, staking, etc. Is there a possibility of funding with ERA?
100%. Yeah. As we sort of move into sort of activating behind RedPocket, I anticipate there will be things that need to be done in sort of supporting it ongoing, where we would open up a pop to allow people to sort of talk about some solutions they would bring to that specific opportunity. But yeah, more to the point, I think once RedPocket goes into the real world, then sockets that can drive more liquidity provision to Pocket through RedPocket, or to Shane's point, different types of solutions that will improve the offerings around gateways or staking, definitely they're things that we would like to see the community sort of generate and start innovating around. So yeah, sockets would be made available for people to just get up and started that with as little friction as possible.
In the original WPocket green paper, the biggest and I think maybe most important mechanism that was driving adoption was farming and support of dApps from the communities of the dApps themselves. Is there anything as part of this plan that, you know, sort of harkens back to that?
The focus right now on the project is to create the primitive, so to make sure that RedPocket exists. And then the thinking is that we can, once it's in place, we can then start to see what the community wants to experiment with, and let those ideas be built around the primitive.
Gone.
Shane's sort of asking a point here, which I'll just read out loud. Yeah, he's sort of talking about maybe many in the community aren't RedPocket or aren't Solidity experts. So are funds available for contractors like Raid Guild? Funds are available to anyone that sort of wants to contribute to different types of solutions. I think a better way that I would describe what Shane's just mentioning there is the nature of the community, I think, changes somewhat in this. You know, our community becomes also the EVM ecosystem and communities there, whereas previously I think we've been quite close to that. So yeah, the funds and the mechanisms will be available to anyone. There's no specific separate line item for contractors to do additional things around it. We would just see that as a growth in the boundary of our community and what's possible, and therefore I think funds would flow perhaps in this case to new community members if that's where the solutions are coming from.
Any other questions around this? All right. So we got all 10 minutes left, so maybe we can open it up as well. Is there any question anyone want to bring up or topics that you'd like to bring up as well as part of the open discussion? Looks like we got Pac News typing. So it's actually a question to Blade. How's Nodes.app rumors of $100 million relay contract? I don't know if Blade wanted to comment on that or not, but yeah, that is a reference that I have seen as well. So yeah, kind of excited.
Yeah, sorry, I had to join from my mobile device. My headphones died. Can everyone hear me?
Yep.
Cool. Yeah, things are looking really great for Nodes.app right now. We're building a lot of foundational services. We actually have projects that is likely going to land this week. And that basically unlocks enterprises to invite and create team members, create individual apps and isolate them with permissions. And yes, we do have some potential relays that are going to come into our application soon. We actually have live traffic to it now. And how we can kind of open this up to the community. I'm working with Giant Frog to kind of come up with a more transparent plan. And then from there, hopefully people will be a lot more excited. Yeah.
Awesome. Well, I'm excited. All right, Alberto asked a question on RatPoc. What are some of the plans around marketing for RatPoc?
So yeah, good question. Marketing generally is about to get a major upgrade at the foundation. Our new head of marketing is joining in just a couple of weeks now, as beginning of July. So yeah, you can expect a lot more proactive marketing campaigns coming out of the foundation very shortly and in time for the launch of RatPocket.
Perfect. Alberto is beyond stalked or stroked. All right, any other questions, comments? It's common by thrilled. Now knowing who Tupac it on Twitter is, which he's implying Jack is, which I'll be interested to hear Jack rap.
Who knows, maybe I am all of the Twitter anons, Pop and News, Tupac, everyone.
But any other questions or comments anyone want to share? All right, if not, we can go ahead and give about 5 minutes back. But yeah, it's been some good discussions, and hopefully you all learn more about the plans for RatPoc, and yeah, excited for that to come forward. So with that said, thank you all for joining, and see you guys next time. Take care.
Nice. Thank you.
Bye-bye. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, Carl.